The year is 1529. Henry VIII is in love, but not with his wife, Catherine of Aragon.
These 20 years I have been your true wife.
Instead, the king is besotted with Anne Boleyn. Henry's determination to divorce Catherine and marry Anne is plunging England into turmoil. What woman could do this?
What kind of woman is it who can inspire a king of England to commit bigamy? Anne's enemies called her a shrew, a whore, a witch. For her friends, she was a patroness of the gospel and good learning. But beyond the praise and the blame, there is the woman, a remarkable woman who risked everything, including life itself, to get the man and the crown that she wanted.
Anne Boleyn grew up in Kent. She was a highly intelligent child, the daughter of a courtier and diplomat. Her father, Sir Thomas Boleyn, was ambitious for her future. When Anne was 12, he arranged for her to leave the family home of Hever Castle to continue her education in one of the centres of European culture, the court of the Archduchess Margaret in the Netherlands.
This is Anne's first letter home. It's addressed on the back, in French, to my father. The letter is written from Vuur. This is a suburban palace just outside Brussels, where the Archduchess Margaret was spending the summer. Anne had been sent to stay with the Archduchess to learn French and courtly ways.
The young Anne clearly shares her father's ambitions that she will one day be a star in the English court.
Sir, I understand that when I come to court, the Queen will take the trouble to converse with me, and it gives me great joy. This will make me all the keener to persevere in speaking French well.
She signs it, "Your most humble and obedient daughter, Anne de Boulain." Over the next few years, she'd plenty of opportunity to perfect her French, because she soon moved to the French court, where she stayed until her early 20s. And when she returned to England, she was, in fact, more French than English. As an admirer later said, "You would never have guessed she was just an English girl. Instead, you would have taken her for a real fine French lady."
Anne's immediate ambitions were fulfilled. She became a lady-in-waiting to the Queen, and she made quite an impact at court. Although not beautiful by the standards of the day, Anne was witty, feisty, confident, and chic. She was expert in intrigue and seduction.
She knows how to use her eyes with
effect. She's a very good wit.
Excellent dancer.
The halls and chambers of the court were a marriage market and a lover's lane. Court regulation actually required that the Queen's ladies should be good-looking, or, if that were not possible, at least not ugly, whilst the King's gentlemen included some of the most athletic and competitive youths in the country. And bringing the two together was court entertainment, which was all about love. Love was the theme of court music, plays and poetry. In this hothouse atmosphere, Anne Boleyn was in her element, and soon one of the most eligible bachelors in the country, Lord Percy, was head over heels in love with her.
It was a breathtaking debut. Anne aimed high and scored. But Percy's powerful family blocked the match. Still, Anne had other lovers.
"Whoso list to hunt, I know where is a hind. But as for me, alas, I may no more."
In 1525, Anne was being serenaded by the poet Thomas Wyatt, To the love-struck Wyatt, Anne was tantalizing and untouchable. His poem tells how he withdrew from the chase when he realized that Anne had another admirer, the king.
And graven with diamonds in letters plain, there is written her fair neck round about. Noli me tangere. For Caesar's I am, and wild for to hold, though I seem tame.
Noli me tangere. Do not touch me, for Caesar's I am. Actually, Henry VIII was a bit premature with the possessiveness. The king could command most things, but he could not command the love of a woman. At least, not of a woman as experienced in the ways of love as the French-educated Anne Boleyn.
For Anne had her own plans. She knew Henry's long marriage to Catherine of Aragon had lost its passion, and it hadn't given the king a son and heir either. Might there be a vacancy for queen? Anne decided to try. She encouraged Henry's attentions, but refused to sleep with him. She'd learned from the experience of her sister, Mary.
Mary had become the king's mistress. She'd surrendered quickly, and she'd been discarded just as quickly. Anne was determined not to share the same fate.
Love letters Henry wrote to Anne while she was away from court show that she decided to treat him tough, to make him tender.
I and my heart put ourselves in your hands, begging you to recommend us to your good grace, and not to let absence lessen your affection.
Anne did not answer the king's letters.
Although my mistress, it has not pleased you to remember the promise you made me when I was last with you. That is to say, to hear good news of you and to have an answer to my last letter.
She deliberately stayed away from court.
I have been advised you will not come to court, which report, if true, I cannot enough marvel at.
And when she did write, she gave him mixed signals.
In debating with myself the contents of your letters, I had been put to a great agony.
Not knowing how to understand them, whether to my disadvantage, as shown in some places, or to my advantage as in others. I beseech you now with all my heart, definitely to let me know your whole mind, as to the love between us.
During 1526, Henry was driven wild by Anne's on-off behaviour and by her retreat here to her family home at Hever. Finally, in December, Henry asked her for a straight yes or no. Would she become his sole mistress or not? Anne replied on New Year's Day, 1527. She sent Henry a New Year's gift of a jewel in the form of a maiden in a storm-tossed boat, and with it, a letter surrendering herself into the king's protection. But the surrender was strictly conditional. She would give herself to Henry fully and physically, only as his wife, not as his mistress. And that meant that Henry had to divorce his present wife of 18 years standing, Catherine of Aragon, first.
It was a shocking ultimatum. Anne was asking Henry to take on Catherine, her friends and supporters, and perhaps even the universal Catholic Church itself. Few women would have been so bold, but Anne had the king at her feet, ready to obey her every whim.
Darling, wishing myself, especially of an evening, in my sweetheart's arms, whose pretty duck is, I trust, shortly to kiss, written by the hand of he that was, is, and shall be yours by his will. Henry Rex.
The king signed his letters like a love-struck schoolboy. HR seeks AB and no other. Henry was determined to make Anne his wife and to consummate their relationship. He believed he could convince the church that his marriage to Catherine was invalid. He asked the Pope to send a special envoy to England to hold an inquiry. Cardinal Campeggio reached London in October 1528.
Henry and Anne were delighted by Cardinal Campeggio's arrival. They persuaded themselves that he was on their side and that their problems would soon be over. Henry even organised the wedding trousseau. This heady optimism made the eventual outcome of the trial all the more bitterly disappointing. Queen Catherine began with a magnificent speech defending the validity of her marriage.
Sir, I beseech you for all the loves that have been between us. And for the love of God, let me have justice and right. Take of me some pity and compassion.
Then the trial drifted on for another month until, without any verdict reached, its sittings were suspended and the case was recalled to Rome.
Anne and Henry were furious at the further delay, but at least Henry could treat Anne regally. He gave her money, splendid clothes, and sumptuous accommodation at court. And in December 1529, he gave Anne precedence over his own sister. Anne was now the king's acknowledged consort. But Catherine was still Henry's wife and queen. Throughout the divorce proceedings, the routine of the court rolled on, and Anne and Catherine had to endure each other's company in public.
Did Anne have any sympathy for Catherine? Did she ever imagine that she might find herself in the same terrible position of a discarded and rejected wife? The answer, simply, is no. Anne was young and confident. She was confident that she had Henry's love, and confident, too, that Henry was rightfully hers. And the fact that Catherine obstinately refused to surrender him meant that she was the enemy, to be undermined in public and private by any possible means.
When Anne heard that the king wanted Catherine to continue making his shirts, she was furious. This bestowed wifely status on Catherine, and Anne was jealous. She now used her clever tongue to cut, not charm. The Spanish ambassador remarked,
"The lady has the courage of a lion. She said to one of the queen's ladies that she cared nothing for the queen and would rather see her hang than acknowledge her as her mistress."
Anne was making enemies.
Within the court, Henry's power and Anne's sharp tongue were just about able to keep feelings under control. But outside, in the towns and villages of England, the churchyards and the alehouses, it was a different story. Here Catherine was genuinely popular, and women in particular sided with her as the wronged wife. Anne, on the other hand, was reviled as a gold digger, as a witch, and a heretic. Characteristically, she confronted the unpopularity directly by choosing as her motto, "Groin que groin," let who will complain. But despite the proud boast, her unpopularity left her dangerously dependent on a single thing, Henry's love and support.
In fact, it was the mighty Tudor king who was in a weak position, caught between these two resolute women. Whilst the divorce case languished in Rome, repeated attempts were made to get Catherine to renounce the marriage. She steadfastly refused. At the same time, Anne refused to grant Henry her full sexual favours until she was certain of being his wife. And Anne hadn't only won over Henry's heart, she was also beginning to establish a measure of intellectual ascendancy over his mind. Anne had long been interested in the radical new religious ideas, and she saw how they could offer a way out of her own predicament. she gave Henry a controversial new book, William Tyndale's Obedience of a Christian Man. This argued that authority over the church properly belonged not to the Pope, but to the King. Henry read it with enthusiasm.
Blocked at Rome, Henry had to think the unthinkable and come up with a solution here in England. The beginning of 1531, he took the first step on a long and rocky road when, under heavy pressure from the king, the English clergy gave Henry a new title. It was Supreme Head on Earth of the Church of England, insofar as the law of Christ allows.
Anne was delighted. As head of the church, Henry would be able to grant himself a divorce. No wonder that Anne, as the Spanish ambassador remarked, made such demonstrations of joy that she might have been admitted to paradise. In July, the king expelled Catherine from court after 22 years of marriage. He didn't even say goodbye. But despite these bold moves, Henry still clung onto the hope that the Pope would somehow give him a divorce. Finally, he grew desperate and realised that he would have to defy Rome. To do this, he needed the support of King Francis I of France.
So, in the summer of 1532, Anne put her excellent French to good use by negotiating in person with the French ambassador. It was decided to celebrate the new treaty by holding a meeting between Henry and Francis at Calais, at which Anne would be present as Henry's official consort. To give her the necessary status, she was created Marquess of Pembroke in her own right. And, Henry decided, she should also be given the Queen's jewels as well.
Only a direct command from Henry forced Catherine to surrender them. So Anne returned to France in style. When she had left the French court, it was to serve the English queen. Now she had usurped her. And it was the lessons that Anne had learned in France, her style, her sexiness, that had won her this prized place by Henry's side. The trip was a great success.
A great storm kept Henry and Anne in Calais for several days after the end of the meeting. It was then, almost certainly, that the couple slept together for the first time. Now, why did Anne, who'd held out for so long, decide to give way this particular moment of time? The explanation, I'm convinced, is that Henry, confident now of French diplomatic support, had told her that, at last, it was safe for them to get married.
So 6 years after Anne first insisted on being Henry's wife, she finally married her prince. She was 32 years old. And she was already pregnant.
With this ring I thee wed, and with gold and silver I thee give.
Officially, Henry was now a bigamist, and the unborn child was a bastard. The plan was to keep the wedding and the pregnancy secret until Henry's divorce was finally resolved. But Anne couldn't contain her triumph, and in February, she decided to show off her state to the court. According to the Spanish ambassador,
the lady came out of her room, and there and then, without rhyme or reason, amidst great company, told Wyatt of a furious hankering to eat apples.
Bring them.
She said the king had told her that it was a sign she was pregnant. She then burst out laughing. Almost all the court heard the announcement, and most were much surprised and shocked.
Anne's gesture in flaunting her pregnancy was typically brash and risky, but the risk was a calculated one. Anne was deliberately drawing attention to the contrast between her fertility and Catherine's barrenness. Catherine's difficulties in bearing children had always been the most powerful psychological argument against the validity of her marriage. Now, in contrast, the fact that Anne had become pregnant so quickly showed, Henry fervently believed, and Anne was now announcing to the court, that their marriage was valid in the sight of God, and that the God who had made Anne pregnant would quickly bless her with a son.
Anne's pregnancy was now official. The news was broken to Catherine. To add insult to injury, Catherine was told that she was no longer queen, nor to be addressed as such. Instead, she would be known by the lesser title of Princess Dowager. The Spanish ambassador was so indignant at the news of Henry's second marriage that he wrote to Catherine's nephew, the Emperor Charles V. He urged the most powerful ruler in Europe to launch a military invasion of England. The invasion, he said, would save the Christian religion and avenge the wrong done to Catherine. But Catherine herself was totally opposed to a holy war on her behalf. She would not act against her husband or bring bloodshed on her English people. In a court at Dunstable, Henry's Archbishop of Canterbury, Thomas Cranmer, was doing the king's business. On the 23rd of May, he declared Henry's marriage to Catherine invalid. 5 days later, he declared Henry's marriage to Anne valid. The following day, Anne's coronation celebrations began. She was on the brink of her ultimate triumph. The build-up to Anne's coronation was magnificent, the celebrations lasting several days. On the 29th of May, 1533, she made a stately progress along the River Thames from Greenwich. 50 great barges, all hung with tapestry and carrying musicians, escorted her all the way to the Tower of London. Anne herself insisted on using Catherine's own royal barge. The old queen's badges were torn off and replaced with Anne's. Even in her hour of glory, Anne wanted to obliterate the memory of her predecessor.
When Anne entered the tower, the guns were still thundering, and she was greeted by the king, who sealed her triumph with a public kiss.
Anne and Henry spent the following 2 nights together in the tower. Anticipating her coronation and the impending birth of a prince, she must have felt utterly secure. On the 1st of June, 1533, Queen Anne was crowned magnificently in Westminster Abbey. The previous day, watched by huge crowds, she had made a great progress through the city of London. Whatever the people thought of Anne personally, however much they preferred Catherine, the coronation gave her the mystical status of queen, and the child in her womb gave Henry hope. Anne's achievement was almost complete. The Pope was outraged by Anne's elevation as Henry's wife and queen. In July, he declared Cranmer's judgments void, instructed Henry to put away Anne, and said that any children they had would be bastards. For good measure, he excommunicated the king, cutting him off from the church and damning him for eternity. Henry ignored him. Anne was confidently looking forward to the arrival of her child. Everyone, including the royal physicians, expected the birth of a son, a prince, an heir. Names were chosen. The baby would be called Henry or Edward. Among the preparations for the great event was the drawing up of a series of circular letters announcing the royal birth to the great and good of England. This is the one that was sent to Lord Cobham. It tells him of the Queen's good speed in the deliverance and bringing forth of a prince. Obviously, they had to leave the day and the month blank. Here it is, filled in for when the birth took place. The 7th day of September. But there's another, more important change. After the word prince, they've squeezed in a letter S to make prince, princess. Because the baby wasn't a boy. It was a girl. Having a daughter was a shock and a disappointment to Anne. A girl would never be the real heir. After all, Catherine's failure to produce a son had been the pretext for the divorce. So Anne hoped and prayed that the baby, Elizabeth, would soon be followed by a brother. Nevertheless, Henry and Anne put a brave face on the matter. The succession to the throne was changed. A new law declared Henry's marriage to Catherine utterly void and annulled. It also declared Henry's marriage to Anne
shall be established and taken for undoubtful, true, sincere and perfect ever hereafter. And also be it enacted by authority aforesaid that all the issue had and procreate, or after to be had and procreate, between your highness and your said most dearly and entirely beloved wife, Queen Anne, shall be your lawful children.
So Anne's daughter Elizabeth replaced Catherine's daughter Mary as the legitimate heir to the English throne. In May 1534, a powerful delegation arrived here at Buckden in Huntingdonshire. Its mission was to get Catherine to swear to the act of succession, to acknowledge that she was no longer queen and that her daughter Mary was no longer princess. Catherine responded by reading in a loud voice the Pope's sentence proclaiming that her marriage to Henry was still valid. Her quiet dignity was gone. Instead, she spoke in anger, in agony, and frequently interrupting the English commissioners. In turn, the English scarcely pretended to listen to her with respect, because they now inhabited different parallel universes. In England, Catherine's marriage was over. In Rome, and perhaps in heaven, it was valid. Unfortunately, Catherine was in England.
Anne loved her daughter, but royal protocol forbade an ordinary mother-daughter relationship. Elizabeth was suckled by a wet nurse and established in a household of her own. Anne put her maternal energy into ordering Elizabeth the finest clothes, but she treated her stepdaughter Mary very differently. Anne deliberately humiliated the girl, declaring that she would make the princess a maid or marry her to some varlet. As these slights were piled on Mary, Catherine wrote to her daughter,
"Obey the king, your father, in everything, save only that you will not offend God and lose your own soul. Speak you few words and meddle nothing. We never come to the kingdom of heaven but by troubles. Your loving mother, Catherine the Queen."
Catherine remained a devout Catholic, but England was changing, thanks in part to Queen Anne, who was using her position to promote her radical religious beliefs. This is Anne Boleyn's own copy of William Tyndale's English translation of the New Testament. Anne's name and titles appear very faintly round the gilded edges of the book, and there is a specially illuminated title page with the English royal arms at the bottom. This may well have been the actual copy of the Bible which Anne kept open on a lectern in her chamber and encouraged her maids to read. Conservatives and churchmen were bitterly hostile to the English Bible and tried to ban it because it enabled lay people to form their own religious opinions rather than blindly following the teachings of the church. By openly displaying the English Bible, Anne was nailing her colours to the mast as a supporter of religious reform. Anne was enjoying her new power in less spiritual ways as well. A massive building programme was underway to transform the royal palaces. At Hampton Court, the Queen's apartments were rebuilt, no expense spared. Everywhere, Henry and Anne's initials were entwined. And Anne was pregnant again.
As usual, Henry persuaded himself that she was carrying his longed-for son and heir. In his delight, the king commissioned a new royal cradle. It was designed by Holbein, built by the royal goldsmith, and trimmed with gold, silver, and enamel. But the cradle was never used. That summer, Anne miscarried. And with the miscarriage, a new note of mistrust crept into the royal marriage.
Full of jealousy, and not without reason, she used words to the king which he did not like, and he told her that she must shut her eyes and endure, and that she ought to know that he could humiliate her in only a moment longer than it had taken to exalt her.
The strain was telling on Anne. She looked older and thin. She herself had risen from Catherine's lady-in-waiting to supplant the Queen. Now she was alive to the threat posed by her own ladies.
Nolae me tangere, for Caesar's I am.
Like a virtuous Protestant queen, she insisted that they dress and behave modestly. But this didn't deflect the king. In June 1535, Anne had another stillborn child. That summer, Anne and Henry made a royal progress to the west of England. Publicly, it was a moment of triumph for Anne as she was shown off outside London as the Queen. Henry and Anne spent one of their nights in this lodge at Iron Acton. The house had been specially built for the visit of the King and the Queen, but here, within the privacy of the royal bedchamber, the tensions were increasing.
It was acceptable for a woman to be difficult and demanding when she was a mistress. But when she became a wife, she was expected to be submissive. Anne Boleyn had refused to make the transition, with terrible consequences for herself, for that feistiness which had so fascinated Henry when he was wooing her. He found intolerable when she was his wife and his queen, and he said so. And Anne had got her complaints too. Later, a dark story suggested that she'd told the lady of her bedchamber that Henry, that monument of masculinity, was no good in bed.
Outside the court, Anne's unpopularity was growing as ordinary people became increasingly uneasy at the religious and political changes. Cardinal Fisher and Sir Thomas More were beheaded for refusing to swear the oath to the Act of Succession. Others met the same fate. Anne was held responsible for this bloodshed.
Heretic.
Goggle-eyed whore.
Stinking sow.
Whore.
During the winter, the court became aware that the king had developed a new fancy for one of Anne's ladies, a modest young woman called Jane Seymour. But it was not clear how the situation would develop. Besides, the Queen was pregnant again. January 1536. England has suffered 5 years of turmoil, and there is more destruction ahead. behind the religious and political upheavals lie changed and broken lives. Henry's passion and pride have destroyed his first family and exalted his second. Now, Catherine and Anne meet the new year in very different spirits. Catherine was dying. 6 years of misery were finally coming to an end. As death grew near, she sent a last letter to her husband.
The hour of my death is drawing on. The tender love I owe you forces me to put you in remembrance with a few words of the health and safeguard of your soul, which you ought to prefer before all worldly matters and before the care and pampering of your body, for the which you have cast me into many calamities and yourself into many troubles. For my part, I pardon you everything, and I wish to devoutly pray God that he will pardon you also. For the rest, I commend you unto our daughter, Mary, beseeching you to be a good father unto her. Lastly, I make this vow, that mine eyes desire you above all things.
But Catherine never saw Henry again. On the 7th of January, she died. Anne and Henry paraded in yellow to celebrate Catherine's death. Anne was delighted. Her rival was finally gone, and her own pregnancy was progressing. But then, only 3 weeks later, Anne went into premature labour and miscarried. The fetus was just identifiable as a boy. It was her third failed pregnancy.
Anne showed great presence of mind and immediately talked of her next pregnancy. But Henry's mood turned black. "I shall have no sons by her," he said. The old curse had returned, and this time its victim would be Anne.
The King's minister, Thomas Cromwell, understood Henry's dilemma. Anne had to be got rid of. The king wanted to remarry and to try again for sons. Another divorce was impossible. A more final solution was needed. Cromwell would attack Anne at her weakest point. He would turn her famous sex appeal against her. First, Cromwell hastily vacated his apartments at Greenwich Palace. Jane Seymour moved in. It was a sign that Jane was now the official mistress of the king. Anne's position was growing ever more vulnerable. 5 days later, an honour that had been intended for her brother went instead to one of Jane's supporters.
Anne was English. That meant that now, at her hour of need, she had no powerful foreign protector to turn to, like Catherine with her nephew, the Holy Roman Emperor Charles V. Instead, Anne's only hope lay in Henry's memories of his first passionate love for her. And Henry's love, Anne knew well, from her own experience of her rise and Catherine's fall, could quickly turn to hate.
Cromwell was grubbing for ways to attack the Queen. As life round Anne was always interesting, he soon found what he wanted. A musician had made love sighs at her. She'd accused a courtier of wanting to marry her. This could be twisted into a charge of adultery, and adultery in a queen was treason. On the 24th of April, Henry authorised an investigation. From now on, events moved quickly. Mark Smeaton, the musician and favourite of Anne's, was arrested. Under torture, he confessed to adultery with the Queen.
May Day was the great feast of love at court, and as usual, it was celebrated with a joust. Anne herself presided as Queen of Love. Her brother George, Lord Rochford, captained one team of knights, whilst Henry Norris, the King's principal body servant, led the other. Norris wore the Queen's colours. Suddenly, at the end of the joust, Henry withdrew, taking a small party with him back to London. Norris was in the party, and on the way, Henry offered him pardon, if only he would confess to adultery with Anne. Indignantly, Norris refused, and he was dropped off at the Tower. Over the next few days, other arrests followed. Francis Weston, William Brereton, Anne's brother himself. All were gentlemen of the King's Privy Chamber, and all were accused of adultery with Anne. On the morning of the 2nd, Anne herself was interrogated before the council, told that she was accused of adultery, and told, moreover, that she would be taken to the Tower.
It was the same route that she'd followed on her coronation exactly 3 years before.
When Anne at last landed at the Tower, it was in triumph on the eve of her coronation. Now she was brought here a prisoner, an accused traitor, almost certainly to suffer and to die. And what made the awful symmetry complete was the fact that she was imprisoned not in a dungeon, but in the luxurious royal apartments where she'd stayed as queen.
Cromwell ordered Sir William Kingston, the constable of the Tower, to record everything Anne said in custody, hoping that Anne would incriminate herself and others. Kingston's first letter described how Anne wept then, fell into a great laughing. This was to be the pattern. In her terror, she did start to talk, and Kingston reported every word.
Francis, I am the King's true wedded Paige. Wife.
Max Meeton.
Oh, my sweet brother.
Oh, Norris, hast thou accused me? And Mark, thou art here too?
Oh, my mother, thou wilt die of sorrow.
Mr. Kingston, shall I die without justice?
Did she also remember Henry's early letters, full of love and promise?
What joy in this world can be so great as to regain the company of her who is the most loved? Darling, I would we were together of an evening, with my hand in yours. Henry Rex.
Pearson.
On the 8th of May, Sir Thomas Wyatt was arrested. 4 days later, Smeaton, Norris, Weston, and Brereton were all found guilty and condemned to death. Meanwhile, the charge against Anne was prepared. The accusation of incest with her brother, Lord Rochford, was intended to blacken her name beyond redemption.
She procured her own natural brother to violate her, alluring him with her tongue in his mouth and his tongue in hers, against the commandments of Almighty God and all laws, human and divine.
Anne was tried in the Great Hall of the Tower of London before 2,000 spectators crammed into the specially built stands. She was tried by a jury of her peers, the noblemen of England, presided over by her own uncle, the Duke of Norfolk. Also in the jury was Lord Percy, her former lover, now Earl of Northumberland. Anne defended herself ably and well. But it made no difference. The verdict of guilty had been fixed beforehand. The Duke of Norfolk read out the sentence to be beheaded or burned at the King's pleasure.
Anne admitted to nothing but her fiery temper.
I have not always borne towards the King the humility which I owed him. I admit, too, that I have often taken it into my head to be jealous of him. But may God be my witness that I have not sinned against him in any other way.
2 days after the trial, Lord Rochford and the other four condemned men were executed on Tower Hill.
On the same day, Anne's marriage to Henry was declared invalid, and Elizabeth was declared a bastard. Anne's own execution was set for the 19th of May. As her death approached, Anne's famous wit turned black. I heard say, "The executioner was very good, and I have a little neck." And then she put her hands round her throat and laughed. They came for her at 8 o'clock in the morning. It had been decided that she should be executed inside the tower walls to restrict numbers and to prevent disorder. They were terrified of what she might say, but they needn't have worried.
Good Christian people, I am come hither to die. For according to the law, and by the law, I am judged. And therefore I will speak nothing against it. I am come hither to accuse no man, nor to speak anything of that whereof I am accused and condemned to die. But I pray God save the king, and send him long reign over you. For a gentler nor more merciful prince was there never. And to me, he was ever a gentle, a good, and a sovereign lord.
To Jesus I commend my soul. Lord Jesus, receive my soul. To Jesus I commend my soul. Lord Jesus, receive my soul. To Jesus I commend my soul. Lord Jesus, receive my soul. To Jesus.
And so it was over. Anne's body was brought a few yards to the chapel of St. Peter ad Vincula in the tower and buried here in front of the high altar. Anne had often prophesied that her career would end in death, but she carried on regardless. And it's this recklessness, this high ambition, boldly and intelligently pursued, that makes Anne the most interesting, if not the most attractive, of Henry's queens. Shortly before her death, she'd done her best to protect the future of her daughter, Elizabeth. We know that Elizabeth would go on to be one of the greatest of English monarchs. Anne didn't. But she did know that her successor, Jane Seymour, was waiting as impatiently and as heedlessly as she'd once done to step into her shoes as queen.